This is State of the Unions. I'm Tim Schlittner.
And I'm Julie Green.
Later in the episode, we're going to be talking with Sara Nelson, the president of the Association of Flight Attendants, part of the CWA. And it's really a fascinating conversation. She was a fun guest and has a lot of great stories. Mm-hmm. So we look forward to that. But first, we wanted to bring you an update on the strikes at Marriott that have been going on. We've been following the minute-to-minute updates on this collective action that swept the country. And today we're being joined by Rachel Gumpert, who's the National Press Secretary of Unite Here. Rachel, thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having us and all the support throughout the strikes.
You got it. So for someone who hasn't been following this minute to minute like we have, can you just give a breakdown of the strikes and why the workers went out and what they got?
Yeah, well, in 2018, we had more contracts aligned for expirations at the same time than ever before for our hotel workers. And what it really allowed us to do is grapple for the first time with the fact that for our hotel workers, many of them have to work multiple full-time jobs just to survive. And this led to, after months of stalled negotiations, ultimately 9 different Unite Here affiliates across the country authorizing strikes of Marriott and actually walking out on strike in 8 different cities with 7,700 workers. The strikes were not resolved until 9 weeks after we first walked out, and we're very pleased with the settlements that we achieved.
I mean, this is a big deal because no one wants to go on strike. When you're out on strike, you're not getting paid, you're not getting your benefits. So 9.5 weeks of that. Wow.
Yeah, it was. I think that our members, we're so proud because our rank and file members really are the lifeblood of Unite Here. Mm-hmm. And the courage and the tenacity we saw on the strike line was absolutely incredible. I think whenever you saw a staff or an elected leader want to maybe check back in with members and make sure that they're prepared to be out as long as they took, the overwhelming answer was always, we are not going back to work until one job is enough to live on at Marriott. So really, it was the courage of our members that kept these strikes going and powerful and allowed us to get the accomplishments that we did out of them.
That's awesome.
Talk about the accomplishments. Give us a highlight of what these workers won in their new agreements.
So the biggest thing that we did is we actually were able to transform hospitality worker jobs in the cities where we struck from something where even if you work full-time hours, you're not able to send your children to college. You're not able to even work one job. You can't afford rent to live independently. Many people had multi-generational housing out of necessity. We transformed all of that in these cities. And that could be in some cities like San Diego, 40% raises across the board for our workers.
Wow.
In San Francisco, the first day back, automatically all of our non-tipped workers got a $1.75 per hour increase automatically that day, more raises throughout the length of their contract there. But really what we achieved is we turned hospitality worker jobs for the richest hotel company in the world into jobs where you can actually live with dignity and support your family for the first time ever.
I think one of the things that I was most impressed in reading what you all were able to accomplish with these contracts are the protections that you built in for your workers. And we had heard a little bit here at the AFL-CIO about the, let me make sure I get it right because sometimes I invert it, the hands-off, pants-on campaign. And basically what that was, and I think it originated in Chicago, was, you know, bringing awareness to the fact that hotel workers, especially maids who are cleaning up your rooms, are some of the most vulnerable to being victims of sexual assault, sexual harassment. And I had just never thought about it from that perspective before about how you're entering a room, you're not knowing who's in there, and sometimes you have someone who is just waiting for you to come in without pants on or, you know, looking to harass you in some way. And you all negotiated an alert system for when these things happen. You want to talk a little bit about that?
So that campaign, Hands Off, Pants On, is very important to not invert. Yeah. And we get that a lot. Hopo was absolutely one.
I've inverted it before and I didn't realize it
happens to the best
of
us because it's so catchy. You just want to say it quickly. But that was one of the most inspiring campaigns that Unite Here ran in 2017. We're very proud of that victory. And actually, it really stands on the shoulders of victories we've had in other cities. Mm. So 6 years ago was the first time that we won safety devices or panic buttons, like they're called. Wow. We secured those in New York City through our very powerful Unite Here Local 6 Hotel Trades Council. So since then, we've been working to address sexual harassment across the board by a measure of different things, including panic buttons or safety buttons. guidance, which give a real-time lifeline where through GPS capacity, a hotel security guard can actually be alerted to exactly where an incident's happening and intervene to protect the worker in real time. We've actually expanded what we consider to be the standard, and we now fight to have language in contracts or in local ordinances that remove the guests who sexually harass or assault workers.
That's great.
You would be surprised that this is actually not the company protocol for any employer, except for in places where they're contractually or legally obligated to do so. Mm. And we do seek bans of guests for several years after they have committed an offense like that.
Wow.
So we're very proud that these settlements of Marriott do have all of the sexual harassment protections that women need to be safe. Mm. And since we won these first in New York City, then actually here in Washington, D.C., in Seattle, in Chicago, in Miami Beach, and now Long Beach and Oakland in the November ballot. So we're very proud that we're really changing the industry for women and taking what was one of the highest rate of sexual harassment at work and making it a place where women don't have to be afraid any longer.
Well, thank you for all you do. I think, you know, traditionally when people think about strike, they think about, oh, you're striking for higher wages, you're striking for better healthcare. But safety is a big issue, even in the hotel industry, when we're talking about this. So thanks for the great work that you all are doing, and we're absolutely going to continue to support it.
We appreciate that.
Julie, I feel like every room we walk into lately, all of the discussions we've been having on this podcast, one of the issues that comes up is technology and how technology is going to impact workers. You guys got some really great language on working people having a say in the deployment of technology, and I feel like it's something we should share with our listeners. Can you go over that?
Yeah, of course. Our international president of Unite here, Dee Taylor, is an incredible visionary, and technology is one of the areas where he's been most ahead of the curve for our union. So years ago, he has started really working to make sure that we see what's around the corner coming for our industry before we're in a crisis mode for automation. So what that meant is that for the first time ever in 2018, we started putting together and securing language in our contracts that will be the union standard going forward for our industry that gives workers a seat at the table in how automation is introduced, where it's introduced, and what pathways there are to keep workers safe in their positions or to move them somewhere else or give them the training they need to be able to still have a good working class job. So we were able to secure great technology and automation protections this spring in Las Vegas when we negotiated with MGM and Caesars Entertainment. And Dee brought that same framework to the negotiations with Marriott. And what we achieved in these settlements was, for the first time with a hotel company of this caliber, we established a national framework where, when we're beginning to grapple with how and where automation could impact workers, we're going to now have a process and a mechanism to have those discussions with management where the workers are at the table truly as equals for the first time ever.
Really awesome. And I'm looking at an article here from the Boston Globe that said Marriott union contract could have ripple effects. Mm-hmm. So all the things we just talked about, protections, technology, the raising standard of living in the hotel industry. What's next for the hotel worker in America?
Well, certainly, I think we have established the new union standard. Unite here is proud that our median wages for hotel workers are nearly double the non-union rates. And that just goes to show how much better all these hotel companies can do if they feel the need to do so. Power concedes nothing without demand, and we're going to continue bargaining to win these standards everywhere. The night that we won our settlement in San Francisco, our president there, Anand Singh, went out to address the media, and he let them know that they have other contract expirations that have already hit in San Francisco. And that we now know what the deal is that we're going to be seeking with Hilton, with Hyatt, with every other chain. Marriott is the leader in the industry, and they have set the standard, and we're going to be holding every other employer to that standard. But most importantly, in 2019, a big fight that's ahead for Unite here is raising the wage and working condition standards for food service workers, particularly airline food service workers.
Yeah.
So I think you're going to really see 2019 being a year where that's a top priority for our union.
So you put them all on notice.
That's right. They're on notice, and they know what the deal's going to be now.
Yeah. It's interesting that you're relating about the airline service workers and our upcoming conversation that we had with Sara Nelson. Not only is she talking about the additional stress that lack of having a full crew is putting on their negotiating ability, but also she touched on sexual harassment and really took us back and kind of gave us an education of just how pervasive that was in the airline industry too. So that was a pretty interesting conversation. But these gains are just, they're so important. They're so critical.
Well, Sara Nelson's been a fantastic partner to Unite here for our sexual harassment work that our international union and hers have done. We've partnered many times over the years. Mm. And it's because she, like us, has recognized and really grappled with this serious epidemic of harassment in both of our industries.
Yeah.
Well, Rachel, you've set us up with a beautiful segue to the interview. Thank you so much for joining us today. And congratulations on this big win for Unite here and for workers across the country.
Fantastic work.
Thank you for helping us win it.
With that, we'll turn to our interview with AFA President Sara Nelson. This is State of the Unions. We are honored to be joined today by the distinguished and very cool President of the Association of Flight Attendants, part of the Communication Workers of America, Sara Nelson. Sara, thank you for joining us.
It's great to be here.
Sara, thought we might start with you telling us and listeners a little bit about AFA.
Okay. Well, the Association of Flight Attendants was founded over 70 years ago, and today it's flight attendants at 20 different airlines, 50,000 flight attendants across the industry. And we are a union that's built of, by, and for flight attendants. So we've been focusing on flight attendant issues. But from the beginning, it has been really important for our union to be a part of the larger labor movement, because unions were joined together to take on the big issues that individual workers can't take on by themselves. And we know that today, especially when we go to bargain healthcare at the table. It doesn't matter what great negotiators we are. It doesn't matter that we have 80% density in the airline industry. We can't take on the issues of healthcare without joining together with other workers who have healthcare under attack and raising the standards for all Americans on healthcare. There's just no way we can move that issue forward. So while we focus specifically on flight attendant issues, we understand our role as part of the larger labor movement as being integral to our success.
We're going to get into that a little bit, but just to give our listeners a little bit of context, can you take us through what the day and the life of a flight attendant is like? Because I think a lot of us fly, but we don't know what's kind of behind the curtain and what you're dealing with, what, you know, you're looking out for and all of that. That might be helpful.
Yeah, so flight attendants are aviation's first responders. Mm-hmm. Think about it. When we go to our workplace and we get up in the air, we're breathing in a pressurized environment, low levels of oxygen. We're pushing 300-pound carts up the aisle with an incline. We're dealing with turbulence. The Labor Department determined at one time that flight attendants had more injuries than coal miners, if you can believe it. And so a flight attendant may wake up at 3 or 4 in the morning to get to the airport. Oftentimes, they don't live where they work. So they live in communities where they can actually afford to live. And then they'll get on an airplane and commute to work, hoping that they can get a seat available or a flight attendant jump seat to get to work, say traveling maybe from Omaha to Chicago to start their day. And then it's a whole wide variety of flights they may work. They may be working on a single flight over to Tokyo, or they may be flying 5 legs that day, up and down all day long, loading passengers off and on the plane, looking during those boarding times to make sure that everyone's going to get to their seat safely, to make sure that there's no conflict between passengers. We now serve as the aviation system last line of defense as well, so we're looking for any strange behavior, trying to keep issues off the airplane. And more today, flight attendants, when they come to work, whether they're flying internationally or a quick domestic flight, the most common thing that we have to do is de-escalate conflict between passengers. And so we've got to be experts in those de-escalation skills, and we're doing that with fewer of us than ever before. While the airlines have rebounded, they're making billions of dollars. Yeah. We've gotten back some of the pay and benefits that we lost during all those bankruptcies in the early 2000s. The staffing levels have not rebounded, so our airplanes are full to the gill, and there's fewer of us to manage those situations.
Is it fair to say there's more tension on an airplane than in the past today?
There's way more tension on an airplane than in the past, because everyone is getting squeezed. Mm-hmm. So the employees are getting squeezed. Passengers are getting squeezed literally into seats that are smaller, closer together. And so anytime you pack humanity into a small space, there's bound to be a little friction. But layer on top of that the social and political discourse taking place in the country today. And what we're finding is that people are quick to react, quick to make snap judgments about each other. Some people come on the plane looking for a fight. And so we've got the great American experience going on at thousands of feet in the air without the ability to call for help.
Wow.
I'd like to go back a little bit and talk about what it meant to be a union member, because I grew up in a small town in Oregon, and my mom was a teacher and she was a member of NEA. We had a good life because of the health care and the secure retirement we knew she was going to have, and the ability to have the time that we needed with our mom. But I didn't really know what it meant to be a union member. We didn't talk about that. I didn't think about coming from a union family when I was in school. And so when I finished my college degree and I was student teaching and I was subbing and I was looking at working in inner city St. Louis the following year, a girlfriend of mine had become a flight attendant. She called up and described the contents of the United Airlines contract to me. And she didn't say that's what it was at the time, but she described those pay and work rules and benefits and retirement. And I drove the next day to Chicago to interview with United Airlines and was hired, went through the 7 weeks of unpaid training and was based in Boston. And my parents were not too happy with me after paying for a liberal arts school.
Had you thought
vacation.
About being a flight attendant before that? Or you, once you heard the contract, you just said,
no, it was all about the contract and about the fact that I love the idea of becoming a teacher. I loved working in the schools and with kids and teaching, but I was staring down student debts and wondering how I was going to make ends work. And as a first-year teacher in an inner-city St. Louis school, that salary was not going to be as much as a first-year flight attendant. And so I looked at the opportunities being a flight attendant would give me, and I decided to try it out. And so I went through those 7 weeks of unpaid training and was based in Boston right away, extremely expensive city to live in.
Was that full-time? 7 weeks full-time?
7 weeks full-time. Oh, yes. Unpaid. They've got you round the clock. Okay. Absolutely. It's a little bit like going through boot camp, except that you're required to go to makeup class and flight attendant training. The men got the day off, but the women had to stay there and learn how to put on makeup. And that was a strange thing for a girl from Oregon who never wore a bit of makeup before that.
That's been phased out, I assume?
No, that still exists, but it operates a little bit different today. Okay. But so I was based in Boston and trying to figure out how to make ends meet, and my roommates got their first paycheck, and I didn't have a first paycheck. I had $12 in my bank account left and too prideful to call and ask for my parents for help. So I made it through. I went down into the office and said, somebody's got to help me. I didn't get for my first paycheck. And they said, well, you get your first paycheck for different times for different reasons, and we're sure you get it next time. And so I crossed my fingers and realized I'm on probation. I need to mind my P's and Q's here, and went out and prayed for those reserve assignments. When you are first starting out as a flight attendant, you don't know when or where you're going to go fly. You just have to wait and by the phone and be ready to go. But I knew that if I could get on an airplane, I could eat some plane food. And so got through those next 2 weeks, and I was working a trip the day before payday. Came home from that trip in Boston. Those van drivers were so great. They'd take us actually home, and the hotel van drivers. And I gave that van driver my last quarter and then went home to my apartment where with seven other women. No one else was home. There was nothing in the cupboards. So I put on my flight attendant uniform the next day and used my train pass to get back to the airport. Flew from Boston to Chicago and back so I could eat some more plane food while I was waiting for my paycheck to drop. Checked my bank account when I landed in Boston. There was nothing in it. So I went down into the office and I said, somebody's got to help me. I still don't have my first paycheck. And they said, well, you get your first paycheck at different times for different reasons. And I'm thinking, oh my gosh, they're not listening to me and they don't care. And I'm a number here. And the tears started to roll and I started to get more upset than someone on probation should. And all of a sudden, I had this tap on the shoulder, and I turned around. There was someone standing there who looked just like me. I'd never seen her before. She's wearing the same uniform, and she's asking me how to spell my name, and she handed me a check for $800. And she said, number one, you go take care of yourself, and number two, you call our union.
Wow.
And so I did call our union. I had my paycheck the very next day. Mm-hmm. But I really learned everything I needed to know in that moment when she was standing in front of me. Because as flight attendants or union members, there's no one better at taking care of others. And through our unions, we can be organized about that and get the most out of it. So what's amazing is I did get involved in the union right away. I went out from my probation exit interview and started leading cheers on the picket line, and we had a contract a year after I started flying, and I thought it stunk. And so did a lot of other people. So we went to the union meeting after this contract ratified by just a little margin, and people are throwing down their union pins. And I'm looking at that and thinking, that looks pretty good. And then, lo and behold, flashing in front of me was the vision of this flight attendant who handed me that $800 check. And I thought, well, we can do better than this because I have met thousands of people just like her. These are amazing people, and we can do better than this. And I kept my pin on that day and encouraged other people too, and got involved and was a real dissident voice. But what's amazing about it is that I learned that the founders of our union created a democratic union that gave ownership of the union to the members. And if you really wanted to change something, if you wanted to make something better, There was a process to do that. I guess I'm the ultimate example of that because I wasn't looking for this, but I kept asking for our union to be better, and people kept asking for me to do more. And lo and behold, I ended up the youngest international president of our union ever, which I think is just really a testament to the democracy that had been built by those women way back in the 40s. And so that's how I got where I am.
You recently spoke emotionally about 9/11, and you referenced some of the early bankruptcies of the early 2000s. You want to tell us a little bit about that day and what your experience was like?
On September 11th is when I really decided that this was work that I needed to do. This was my calling. This is where I needed to be, because on September 11th, 2001, I was based in Boston, and a week earlier I had flown flight 175 that ended up at the World Trade Center South Tower, and some of my dearest friends were on that flight. Amy, Michael, Robert, Catherine, Al, Alicia, Jesus, Marianne, and my flight attendant manuals in the New York Museum. And their training, my friends' training on board that flight, was to appease the hijackers, to de-escalate any conflict on board, to try to keep everyone calm. It was the exact opposite training that they should have had for that moment to take on the war that we didn't know we were fighting. But what they did was, even though their flying partners had been some of the ones to first get their throats slit, others got on the phone, got intelligence to the company and to our military and to our country to alert people about what was really happening on these planes. And what's amazing about it is that Flight 93, just an hour later, that information got to our friends there. And Flight 93 had a crew of all women in the cabin. It had people who were Asian American and African American and Latinos, and a woman who was pregnant, a man up in first class who was in his mid-20s, who was a gay rugby player and an advocate for marriage equality. This is all of America. Mm-hmm. Democrats, Republicans, Independents. Yeah. And in a moment's time, they decided to come together as Americans. Mm-hmm. And fight against that. And they ended up sacrificing their own lives so that they could save countless others on the ground. But I think about that, and I think about every single day when flight attendants go up in the air and they have to count on each other.
Yeah.
In an pressurized environment with little oxygen and sometimes poisonous gas because of the way that the oxygen flow is is incorporated into the cabin. And they have to call on other people to say, we're in this together. We're going to treat each other well, and we're going to get safely to our destination. And today, with the rhetoric that's happening in this country, I know it's making us less safe. Mm-hmm. And I question whether or not it's creating a dynamic that would interrupt that extraordinary effort by those people on Flight 93 who came together as Americans, understood they were in it together, and ultimately were willing in a moment's notice to stand up and fight for who we are.
Where were you that day?
I had just landed in Chicago for a union training, and on my way over to the office for the training, we were getting word on the hotel van. And I walked into the office, and our officers had already been called and been taken over to the crisis center at United Airlines. And the people in the office didn't know yet. TVs weren't on. Mm-hmm. You didn't have the constant feed of social media. And I came in the door crying, not even knowing that it was a United flight yet, but knowing that it was American and that we were under attack. And so we got the TVs on. I was with them. We helped track down the crews. And I remember standing in the office when we got word that United Flight 175 had been lost in New York. And I remember just being surrounded by my fellow union leaders, and actually one woman who had been working in our union for over 30 years caught me because I started to go down and stayed by my side the rest of the day until I got in a car with some other flight attendants and drove back to Boston so that I could be with everyone and get to the crisis center and start to try to make sense of this. But, you know, I'll never forget it. It was a defining moment. It was the day that I think I learned what it is that I'm supposed to do. And it has been a calling ever since to make sure that aviation security remains top-notch.
Thought maybe we'd talk a little bit about sexual harassment. Yeah. The labor movement obviously is focusing on this issue now. Maybe start with your perspective for this issue and flight attendants.
When the Me Too movement broke, we recognized that this was maybe an opportunity to stamp out coffee TRME permanently. Mm. And we started hearing from flight attendants who had never spoken up about how they were harassed or assaulted. And
what is coffee TRME?
Coffee TRME is a famous book that was put out, really describing the flight attendant career and talking about how flight attendants were viewed. Mm-hmm. As serving up coffee, tea, or mm-hmm. me. Right. There were ads that said things like, "I'm Cheryl, fly me," that airlines would promote. And they were literally selling flight attendants as sex objects when they were trying to sell tickets. And that was never denounced by the industry. We just cut our own path. There were flight attendants who really found worth in each other, like I said, by sticking together and defining our jobs through contract negotiations and legislation, regulation, and even court battles as well. But at work, we had to figure out how to make that work. But what we found when this broke was that we were hearing from a lot of flight attendants about their stories, and we were not hearing from men. And I was curious about that because I wanted to talk about this moment, about lifting up women and women's seat at the table and equalizing that power struggle. But I was also curious because I had witnessed myself men being sexually harassed who were my flying partners. Talked with some of them, and the conclusion I came to from talking with these male flying partners was that they recognized exactly what we know, that sexual harassment is not about body parts. It's not about gender. It's about power,
yeah.
Pure and simple. And in a workforce that's 80% female, they need this moment in time to be about power for women and women claiming their power, because they can't go to the table and bargain what they think they're worth unless 80% of their flying partners believe that they are of the same worth.
That's
too.
Right.
And so for us, this is about finally stamping out that idea that flight attendants are just objects and understanding the real role that we fill, not only as aviation's first responders responding to safety emergencies, medical emergencies, being the last line of defense, but also on the front lines of a discussion in our country about who we want to be. And flight attendants really have a responsibility and an opportunity to set a tone in the country. And so this has been important for us to be outspoken on this. We conducted a survey of our members to better understand what's really happening out there. The numbers are overwhelming. 1 in 5 flight attendants have been physically assaulted on our planes in the last year. And so this is an issue. If we're gonna demand respect on the airplane, this is where we work, and we're gonna demand a safe space for everyone on our planes. Women who get on our planes shouldn't have to think about when they buy a ticket. Oh, I don't want to fly in a night flight. I better not have earphones in. I better not sit in a window seat. Better not drink, a glass of wine because I've got to remain alert because I might get sexually assaulted on this plane. That's not the kind of experience that we want to have for our mothers and our sisters and our daughters in this country. And if we don't take this on and take this seriously and stamp out this idea of sexual harassment and that someone can be underneath someone else's control in this way, we are going to fail to see half the ideas in this country for solutions. And we're going to fail to have a conversation at the table that's born out of mutual respect.
I was struck by the number you gave of flight attendants who say they were physically assaulted in the last year. Yeah. Just going back to that for a second. Would you be comfortable sharing your own experience with sexual harassment in the workplace?
Sure. So let me say that as a union leader, what I have experienced at the table with a contempt from certain managers for flight attendants has often borne out in disrespect or comments even about me or the way that I look or how I'm dressed, mm-hmm. how my hair is done.
I can relate.
Yeah. Yeah. So I can talk about my experience on the line as a working flight attendant and having someone come up behind me and pat me on the rear end and say, oh, no girdle? How could you look this good in your uniform without a girdle? Now, this is back 20 years ago when I started flying. Being in a seat in a flight attendant uniform up against the window, sleeping, like I said, and waking up to someone physically assaulting me and trying to make sense of it, not really knowing what to do, not having any idea that anyone's going to care. Mm-hmm. I mean, let's be clear. 15 years ago, thinking that anyone would care other than my fellow flying partners who I desperately wanted to get a hold of, but an inebriated man over me, overpowering me, and what's going to happen if I now call for help? Is someone going to get there in time? Is this going to escalate? People need to understand that this is how sexual harassment and sexual assault works to keep victims quiet.
Yeah.
Because it's horribly embarrassing, right? You don't know if you're going to have backup, if you're going to report it. 7% of those surveyed in our survey had reported it. 93% had not reported physical assault. This can then be perpetuated, because if you are a victim who speaks up, then you're the person who destroyed that person's life or destroyed that person's job. And we had other flight attendants say that they had come forward to managers, and the response would be, now, are you sure you want to report this about this this station supervisor who sexually harassed you? You know, you're going to ruin his life. You're going to take away this man's job. Are you sure you want to do that? We have to bring everyone to the table. And if we bring everyone to the table, it's more likely that we're going to have a different array of options and solutions that work for everyone. And it's less likely that we're going to allow the conditions around sexual harassment to exist and work, because women will not be seen as the lesser in that equation, and the inability to speak up because the people she's got to speak up to are not just men, but now they're men and women.
I don't know if this is true for you or not, and the thing that I think personally for me is so important about this year and how this is out there now is that even in my own experience, whether it's been physical or verbal, my first thought was, what did I do? What did I do? What did I say? How did I present that would invite this person to say or do this thing to me? And it's always pissed me off because the answer is, you didn't do anything. You're doing your job. You're doing, you know, whatever. But my initial instinct was, well, let me look inward. What I must have done something.
Yeah, what did you do? Let me think about this. You got dressed. You brushed your hair. You might have put on a little makeup. You went to your job looking professional. That's what you did.
Yeah.
And in a moment's notice, if we allow this kind of environment to exist, that can be turned into, well, you look too good, so you were asking for it. And that's just not okay, but that's the environment that we live in today. And if we don't have women as part of the solution, we're not going to change that dialogue. So take, for example, the FBI has been great. They've been putting out notices that say that this is a federal offense on planes, sexual assault, you can be facing major consequences. And then the very next thing they do is list the top 10 things that women can do to avoid getting sexually assaulted. Okay? Now, I understand that's the environment we're living in, and they're trying to be really helpful to people, mm-hmm. right? They're trying to promote public safety there. But that's the wrong paradigm. Right. That is not the way to be approaching this, right? The behavior is unacceptable. The objectification is unacceptable. And the idea that a certain group is going to have power over other individuals just because of who they are, the gender they are, the color of their skin, is unacceptable. And it's un-American.
At the end of our interviews, we like to play rapid fire, which is a little fun. So, Julie, you want to start?
Yeah, what's your favorite airport?
Boston.
Boston. Why Boston?
Well, Boston, just because it's home. All right, beyond that, San Francisco is great. It's totally restyled and lots of good restaurants, and you can get a massage, too, if you're delayed.
How about favorite destination?
Hong Kong. Hong Kong is an extraordinary city, a city that grows out of vegetation and is on all these different layers and tons of humanity.
Weirdest passenger experience?
Weirdest passenger experience was coming out of Las Vegas. Some guy who got by us who we didn't realize was on, I don't know, a lot of things. He ended up, I had two brand new flight attendants working with me in the back, and he was about 6'6", close to 300 pounds, and he did a strip tease for people.
Oh,
he urinated all over the back galley. He tried to open the doors. And we spent so much time reporting this to the cockpit and to the ground, and we didn't have any helpers on the plane, any people who could match him. I went back there with my best trained teacher voice and finally said to him, look, he's on something. He's like way gone. I said, look, you need to sit down. You're going off this airplane in handcuffs. So you can either do it in Omaha or in Chicago. If you sit down and be quiet and don't touch anybody else the rest of the flight, you get to go off in handcuffs in Chicago. And he did. He sat down the rest of the flight. We didn't have to do anything else. We didn't have to restrain him. He sat in his seat. The police came on the plane and escorted him off in Chicago. And that was the strangest flight. And those poor flight attendants questioned whether or not they wanted to continue in this career after that. But there you go.
Vegas claims another victim.
Yeah.
So, say Julie and I are sitting next to each other on a plane, and we get into an argument that escalates into a fight, and Julie and I are at each other's throats. What's your de-escalation technique?
Oh, boy. Well, the first thing is to get the two of you apart from each other. And the hardest thing is to get people to volunteer to sit next to you now because you're both troublemakers, right? We've got to get people apart, and then we talk to people individually. And that sometimes is using that teacher voice. And other times is using a technique and lowering our voice and bringing people down and kneeling down. But it may also include, if you're really out of control, we may ask for some other passengers to help to restrain you. All of this is really hard because flight attendant staffing is at minimums. So this is our next effort, is to increase flight attendant staff, because United Airlines just announced that they're going to follow American and Delta and cut staffing on long-haul flights. And they're giving the excuse of pre-plating meals, which is, you know, great service also for the passengers. But I've talked to Unite here, and guess what? They're not staffing up the kitchens to do that work. So they're going to put more work on us. There's going to be fewer of us to respond to these incidents that you're describing of conflict on board the plane. And in the kitchen, they're going to put more burden onto the people who are catering those meals to do more work there without giving them staffing. This is more productivity that's being eked out of our system in an industry, as an example, that's making billions of dollars. That over the last 2 years, the top four airlines have promised $12 billion in stock buybacks. But they've got to take another flight attendant off the plane and not increase the staffing in the kitchens and have all of us pay for it and put it on our backs and make people less safe. This is what we're fighting in our union, and I think it is analogous to what's happening across America.
It's what the country is starting to reject.
Yeah.
It's what the country is starting to reject, and I am really gratified to see the response from the American public on the United Postal Service. You know, this is the People's Postal Service, and this is how we get our medicine, and this is how everyone in any community, no matter what your community looks like, has this access to the same shipping system, the same price. And these are good union jobs that would be cut if it were privatized. But I'm seeing America reject that idea, right? The People's Post Office is older than our Constitution. And this is ingrained into our communities. So it's been gratifying, actually, to stand alongside the postal unions in that fight as well. And I think that this is really about Americans standing up and saying, you know what, you're going to stop taking from us, and we're going to stand together. This is the perfect time. 62% approval rate of unions in this country right now. All we have to do is make the ground fertile and get people to rise up in their workplace and join together and join unions. We can actually organize on a grand scale of millions of workers in the next year if we put our minds to it and use the resources of the union power that we have today with 13.5 million members who can tell the story of having a contract, having a voice at work, and feeling that dignity on the job because they have that voice.
Amen. 62%, well, highest in 15 years.
Yeah.
Let's do something with it.
Let's do something with it. I'm ready.
Sara, thank you for your honesty, your vulnerability, sharing all these stories, some of which I know were tough during this, but I feel like I learned a lot. I'm going to be on a flight tonight. I'm going to be very nice and thank all of my flight attendants because I had no idea just how much you all are dealing with behind. And thank you for your leadership and all you're doing to keep us safe.
Thank you very much. And they will love to hear from you and they will love to take care of you because there's very few people who get their faces out of their phones when they get on board the plane. So just saying hello, saying thank you and connecting with them as human beings is something flight attendants will appreciate. And I think that that's what everyone is looking for is dignity at work, respect at work, and the ability to do a good job.
You've been listening to the president of the Association of Flight Attendants, Sara Nelson. Sara, thanks again.
Thank
you. This is State of the Union.
This has been State of the Unions. Thanks for listening. Join us every other Wednesday for a conversation about the labor movement, organizing, and all the things that affect us at work. Make sure you never miss an episode by subscribing and rating us on iTunes, Google Play, or wherever you get your podcasts.
We also wanted to tell you about our upcoming Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Civil and Human Rights Conference. The theme is The Fierce Urgency of Now. It kicks off Friday, January 18th, a three-day conference that includes a day of community service and coincides with the Women's March on Saturday, January 19th. Registration is now open. You can visit our website, themlkconference.org. Again, that's themlkconference.org. And until next time, keep up to date on all things labor by following us at AFL-CIO.